My name's John Henry Faulk. I was raised down in on a farm out south of Austin, Texas. Both sides of my family were Southern, having come from Alabama and Tennessee in the 19th century. And in the area where I was raised, there were a great number of black families. And matter of fact, two families lived on our farm there. And so I was raised in listening to the folk music and the folk stories and the delightful idiom and the colorful yarns of the black people, and was always rather enchanted by it. But back in 1930s, when I was a graduate student, the latter part of the 30s, I was a graduate student at the University of Texas. I was had fallen very much under the influence of J. Frank Dobie and Alan Lomax, both great folklorists, and I began to collect folklore, concentrating on black folklore, really. We had no recording machines in those days, at least I didn't have one. I would do it with by notes and also by listening very closely. I was had a good ear for folk speech and the idiom of the people, and listened to the nuances and the sounds, and could do a fair job of reproducing the folk songs as well as the folk tales that I heard in the idiom of the people. It became quite popular around telling before civic groups and women's study groups and that kind of thing, telling of my folk collecting. But folklore then was regarded as a strictly an idiosyncrasy on my part by everyone that knew me, and as a matter of fact, it was kind of an academic aberration in the eyes of most people, that the only people that collected folklore were a half dozen academic types and myself. And I went after it with a zest, though. I genuinely loved it. And would travel out to little churches and remote areas and to farms where blacks lived in quite isolated lives, and just enjoying daylights out of myself. But you see, I was raised in a tradition of storytelling and listening to stories. And I had a number of ancient aunts and uncles and cousins that would come and stay with us, and I doted on their stories of the old days, the Confederacy, and had a couple of aunts that had lived during slavery time, and they'd tell of those happy days when the South was a gracious wonderland and everybody was polite to everyone else, and how sweet old the masters always were to the slaves, and how devoted the slaves were, and even later, when freedom came, how devoted the blacks always were to the whites. These were the tales that the whites told. And interestingly enough, there were a number of elderly black people, too, that were very close to my family and very close to me, and I loved to hear their tales. And their tales reflected the same attitude, that those were the good old days. The white folks were just so good to the black folks. And yes, sirree, my white folks were just couldn't have been better to me, they'd tell you. And I grew up genuinely believing this to be a fact of life, that utterly unaware of the condescension and patronizing attitudes that had become part of my whole pattern of behavior in the presence of blacks. I believed devoutly in the old saying that was repeated and I had been taught since I was a child, that namely, nobody understands our colored folks like us good Southern white folks understand them. This was a believed to be an absolute fact. At any rate, I got a Rosenwald Fellowship in my graduate years in about 1941. And really seriously started going out into the field to collect folk material amongst the blacks. And it's a very interesting thing happened then. I was thrown in with blacks all the time. I spent all of my time with them. And slowly but surely, there began to dawn on me a fact that had absolutely astounded me. Namely, that the blacks put on one face for the white man and talked one way to the white man and quite another to one another. They had, and I began to detect and slowly became conscious of the fact that the black community that I moved amongst with in my condescending, patronizing way. Oh, I was ever so kind. I was ever so gracious to them, you know. But I became conscious that actually there was a deep undercurrent of resentment. And I know it sounds silly today to think that a grown man is supposed to be intelligent and college bred had no more sense than to not realize what a deep, deep resentment the black man carried in his heart for the 24-hour day injustices that he suffered from the time he was born until he left this life. None of this, incidentally, was an overnight discovery on my part. It was a long, painful, gradual experience that came about in the course of a year or so of me understanding. It was hard for me to face the fact that I was actually a nothing more than a white bigot. I began to encounter blacks after they got to know me and came to trust me and realized that I was quite serious about collecting, would tell me the truth, as it were, about how they really felt. And I became absolutely preoccupied with reaching such a rapport with them that they would tell me exactly what their experiences were like in life. As I say, this took a long time. It took a great number of acquaintances, one of whom I remember that was very important to me, was old Mr. Tim Owens. He was a gentle old black man that lived down near Hearn, Texas. And we really became close friends, Mr. Tim and I did. And he'd love to say, "Oh, Lordy, yes, honey, I remember the good old days. Lord, our white folks was awful good to us, you know. They'd let us go on fish fries and have big frolics. And, Lord, I worked for Mr. Charlie Wilson. He was my white folks, you know. Mr. Charlie Wilson, mighty good to his colored folks. And there was a Christmas come. He wouldn't give us apples and oranges and cookies, you know, and just there'd be more laughing and hoorahing, and we'd just have the best time. Oh, them was the good days. Yes, so Mr. Charlie Wilson, mighty good to his colored folks. Mighty good to his colored folks. Of course, he was kind of hard on them that time. Kind of hard on them at times, you know. Mr. Charlie Wilson, he had over 100 head of people living on his place. Me and my wife, Nellie Mae, we was sharecropping now on his place. And there's all sharecroppers. But they was kind of like it was still slavery time. Now, this back in the 1920s, I'm talking about, child, I think it was 1921 or 22 that we were working with Mr. Charlie Wilson. And he had all the big farmers down here, like Mr. Charlie Wilson in that day and time down here, had these big farms, you know. It worked a whole lot of hands. Well, they had a rule that if a man didn't want to work, if he had a hand on his place that didn't want to work, Mr. Charlie Wilson would chain him to the cultivator early in the morning at daylight, and he'd have to ride that cultivator all day. Mr. Charlie would send him out something to eat at noontime, you know, for his noontime dinner. Then he'd go head on work, have to come back in. Nobody, Mr. Charlie Wilson, could unchain him from that plow. That was kind of rough. That was kind of rough. Mr. Charlie Wilson had his rules. And, of course, if during cotton picking season, any of the black hands down here, any of the colored folks, they run off the place and go off somewhere else to pick cotton where they could make more money. Mr. Charlie Wilson, he'd get hold of the deputy sheriff, and he'd get a warrant out for him and bring him back. Mr. Charlie Wilson believed in getting work out of his folks. But as I say, he was a good man. Well, after Mr. Tim Owens told me several other stories like that, I began to realize that Mr. Tim Owens had some interesting things that he could tell me if I could just persuade him to do so. So one afternoon, I was sitting with him and said, "Mr. Tim Owens," I'd always call him Mr. Tim Owens, and as he pointed out, I was the first white man that ever called him Mr. And I said, "Mr. Tim Owens, you know, I'd like for you to tell me really what it was like to be a black man back there 25 years ago, or He, I would say he's about 60 years old at that time. And Miss Tim Owen sat and thought about it a long time. And then all of a sudden he looked up and sort of smiled at me and said, "I'll tell you what I'll do, Mr. Johnny. I'll tell you some of the things that went on then that I reckon kind of burned into my soul. I's an old man now. I ain't going to be here much longer, I don't reckon. And ain't nobody could do me no devilment anyhow. But since you wants to hear it, I'll tell you. Me and my wife, Nellie Mae, we had 6 children. We loved them children. And we was working shares on Mr. Charlie Wilson's place. Like I say, in his way, he was good to us. He always treated me like I was kind of a pet to him. He'd always call me old Timmy. Yes, there come my old Timmy nigger. That's what he called me. But he meant it good-natured like, you know. He'd always try to act fair with us, no. Our oldest daughter was named Gracie Mae. And Gracie Mae, I guess, prettiest little old girl you ever saw. Bless her little old heart and just as smart, you know. Help her mammy out taking care of the other children. She could get out there in the field and work. But that wasn't the best thing Gracie Mae could do. She's 16 years old, and she done learned to sew and iron, do the washing, keep house, cook just good as her mama could. Me and Nellie Mae is awful proud of our little old Gracie. Awful proud of her. And she got it into her head that one of these days she's gonna make her some money and go off and go to school somewhere and be a school teacher or something high, you know, like that. Mammy and I told her that's just what we'd love to see her do, and in any way we could see that she done it, we was going to see that she done it. That's why we was real happy when we got word that Deputy Sheriff Mr. Brad Thompson, he live over the way yonder a piece, him and his wife, that they needed some help around the house. Want somebody could do a little cooking, because she was doing poorly, Miss Thompson was. So Mr. Brad Thompson, he come got Gracie and put her on the job. And he give her $2 a week. Come out there and get her. She walk over yonder most time, but sometime he come get her in the car and then drive her back, you know, because he had that deputy car. Then one night, Gracie come home and say Miss Thompson been gone and said she wasn't going back over to Brad Thompson's house no more. Brad Thompson always trying to touch her and all such as that. And that day he had forced her down on the bed because his wife wasn't home and took advantage of her. She was crying. She'd come home crying. He said he'd slap her around, mistreat her that way, and said she wasn't never going back. She didn't care what he tried to pay her, no more to work at that place. Me and Nellie Mae, we were nervous over that, you know, but we never did have no trouble with no white folks at all. But yet and still, Gracie Mae, an awful sweet girl, we knowed she'd telling us the truth. Well, that was a Saturday, and long just for dark, here come Mr. Brad Thompson in that deputy's car, his. He called out, "I was sitting out here on the porch." Gracie, she run in the house and hid. Brad Thompson come down here. Great big man, you know, big red-faced man. Carrying that big old pistol on him. And he said he needed Gracie. Gracie up there needed up there at the house because he's going to have company the next day. And his wife was down in the back. She come home sick and couldn't take care and wanted Gracie to come up there. Wanted to come go with him. So I told him, I said, Mr. Brad Thompson, Gracie, I'm afraid she's sick. She's feeling bad. Like, I don't believe she can go off. She in there in bed. Brad Thompson said, "Ain't nothing the matter with her. She's up the house this morning. I want that nigga out here now." Well, then he lit in and started cussing me, saying I'd better be careful that he had killed niggas for a heap less than them just talking back to him. And I explained to him, I said, "Mr. Thompson, I ain't trying to talk back to you, sir. I ain't wanting no trouble. You know me well enough to know that, Mr. Thompson." All of a sudden, old Brad Thompson, he looked real sober, and he stand there studying at the gate a minute, and then he said, "You send that gal out here. You know what I'm down here for. I'm down here to arrest her. She knows what she done, and she is herewith under arrest." And I said, "Lord have mercy, what has Gracie done, Mr. Brad Thompson?" He said, "She know what she done. My wife missing a brooch and money out of her purse." All of a sudden, I got mad, Mr. Johnny. I wasn't gonna let him pull no stunt like that. I knowed what he wanted to do with Gracie. I'd gonna stand up for my wife and my daughter, and I stood up there on the porch and I said, "Well, she ain't going with you. You gotta go get whatever they law require you get before you can take her. You gotta get a paper before you can take her." Mr. Brad Thompson said, "Look here, nigger. Don't you ever let yourself get caught interfering with a legal arrest. This is a legal arrest." And then he go back to the car and get a pair of handcuffs. He said, "Now get that girl out here." Nellie Mae was crying and saying it's all just a lie. She hadn't cared nothing on him. He knowed she hadn't cared nothing on him. Bless goodness, he throwed them handcuffs on to her. And her mama and her little brother and sisters and me had to stand there and watch him shove her into that car and drive off. It just hurts me all inside every time I think about it now, how that made me feel. Seeing that old animal can her off. I don't mean that all white folks are that way, but that's what he done. Claimed she stole something and had her little old arms handcuffed up there. Well, Mr. Tim sat there and I could see his face clouding with just the memory of this traumatic experience. And I said, "Well, Mr. Tim, my God, didn't you go and tell your boss man about it? Mr. Charlie Wilson, who's your great protector, didn't you go tell him that they'd taken Grace off, arrested her for stealing?" He said, "Yes, I sure did. I went straight up to Mr. Charlie Wilson's house. It's just about dark, and he's sitting down with a whole heap of company for supper this here Saturday night. My wife was crying, and Nellie Mae went with me. I explained to him that what Mr. Brad Thompson done, and Mr. Charlie Wilson patted me on the shoulder and said, well, he'd go down Monday down to the courthouse and see about that. And I said, but that she'd be in jail 2 days. Then Mr. Charlie Wilson kind of got mad. He said, look here, I got a house full of company and they staying over tomorrow. I ain't gonna have time to piddle around with no nigger resting now. He turned around and went back in the house. There wasn't nothing me and Nellie Mae could do, and we knowed we couldn't. Well, he come down Monday, Mr. Charlie Wilson did, and he say Gracie had owned up that she had stole that. And they had told her to get deputy sheriff had turned her loose and told her to get out of the county and not come back again. He wasn't going to allow no stealing niggers in this county. And he got her a ride down to Houston. I said, well, what did Mr. Charlie Wilson say about that? Well, I argued Mr. Charlie Wilson. I told him, I said, Mr. Charlie, that's our oldest daughter. You know Gracie Mae ain't going to steal nothing. You know that's all just talk. Ain't there no way we can get her back here? Mr. Charlie Wilson looked at me. And he said, look here, Tim, I ain't never took a nigger's word against a white man's word yet. And if Deputy Thompson say that gal stole, she stole. I don't aim to start letting niggers tell me how to run this county. That was the end of it. And I said, well, didn't Gracie Mae ever call you back, Mr. Tim? Write to you? He looked at me with a sad kind of a smile and said, Gracie Mae hadn't never learned to read, but just kind of spell her name. Not on daddy, she writ us a letter. We none of us here at the house could have read it. I reckon one of these days we'll see her again, though. As I say, this kind of thing, I keep running into experiences like this, and I know it sounds odd to say it today, that was, after all, just 30-odd years ago that was going on, that I was a grown man before I fully comprehended the cruel and violent injustice that a fellow human being had to live with every day of his life simply because he had been born with a black skin. And it was about that time that I began to refer to the injustice of racism in my speeches before civic clubs and women's literary groups that I was invited to speak before on the subject of folklore. And I was honestly under the impression that my audience would react as I had reacted with this injustice, because I knew them to be my neighbors. I knew them to feel as I did about injustice. But a fascinating thing happened. To my surprise, I discovered that my remarks were only met with hostility. They stirred up a discomfiture in the audience. And friends would tell me, said, "Johnny, you know, you ought to leave that sermonizing out of your remarks. I'll tell you, you're going to get to be known as a stir up of trouble amongst niggers, and they run you out of the state if you do that, boy." And I guess I came to fancy myself something of a crusader. Goodness knows, a very ineffective one. And it was about that time that I ran into one of the most remarkable men I'd ever known, an old black man down in the Trinity Bottoms. He was a farmer all week, and he was a minister in the old Shiloh Baptist Church on Sundays. And I became very interested in collecting his folk sermons. As a matter of fact, one of them is in my master's thesis at the University of Texas. My thesis was on 10 Negro sermons that I did for my master's degree. And Reverend Tanner Franklin had first caught my attention in this little church that sat sideways, leaning, unpainted, just a single lantern hanging from a crossbeam. One night during services in the summer, when Reverend Tanner Franklin was preaching on the subject of we have to stand up to move ahead, we have to stand up to get the job did, and he's standing there, a congregation had about 18 or 20 people in it, all of them farm folk like Reverend Tanner Franklin. And incidentally, Reverend Tanner Franklin was completely illiterate, but he'd leaned his ear over close to the earth and he'd caught the sounds and the rhythms of the earth, and he knew all the things that grew out of the earth. It wasn't a wild flower that blossomed down there that Reverend Tanner Franklin couldn't identify by its perfume. And it wasn't a wild bird that sang down there that Reverend Tanner Franklin couldn't identify by its song. And on this particular night, he was preaching, and his sermon, the text of his sermon came from the Old Testament, the story of David and Goliath. And he got to describing little Goliath, selecting himself five smooth stones. Reverend Tanner Franklin was dramatizing it there in the lantern light. He said, "And yonder he go all alone and by himself, that lone little child David, marching against the mightiest force the world had ever seen at that time, the mighty Philistine army. And yonder stand old Goliath, so many cubits high I can't number them all, had never been defeated in battle. Standing there pawing the ground, stomping his foot on the ground, shaking acorns off the tree way over yonder in the next county. And he looked and spied little David coming up the slope. And he said, 'That's an Israelite trick, sending a shirt-tailed youngin' over here to battle with me. Child, you better turn around and get home to your mama. I'll step on you and not leave enough for the buzzards to pick.'" And church, up in Zion that morning, God got word that his child David was fighting his battle for him. And he called angels together and he said, "Stand the sun still in the heavens where it's at. Hush the winds down in the four corners of the earth. Some of you angels move around heaven and find me a big bright rainbow to wear around my neck for a scarf this morning. And some more you angels bend low with your wingtips and sweep the skies clear. 'Cause I want a clear view of my child David fighting my battle for me down there this morning." Well, that's just a very poor imitation and partial reference to Reverend Tanner Franklin. I want to give you a taste of the poetry, the epic quality of this man. As I say, he was completely illiterate. But he was one of the real wise men that I've ever encountered in my life, because his heart was completely free of any scintilla, even a hint of prejudice against any fellow man, whatever his color might be, whatever his condition might be. He didn't have time for that. Reverend Tanner Franklin stood too tall. And late one afternoon, we were sitting out on a wagon tongue in Reverend Tanner Franklin's backyard. And I was trying to impress him with what a change was coming back in about in me, that in my attitude toward the colored people, that I'd realized what injustices they lived with. And in a spurt of self-aggrandizement and pride, I said, "Well, you know, Reverend Tanner Franklin, I've changed. I'm a different kind of white man. You'll encounter very few like me. For instance, I believe, Reverend Tanner Franklin, in giving you colored folks the right to vote." At that time, they couldn't vote in Texas. And I went on expanding on that, and I said, "I believe in giving you a right to go to good schools, and I believe in giving you a right to live in dignity and peace, and not suffer the abuses you have to suffer." Of course, as I sat there making these remarks to Reverend Tanner Franklin, I figured he would be so profoundly impressed and overjoyed to hear what a splendid, gracious, generous man I was, and what a liberated mind I displayed, that he would practically fall on his knees and grab me by the hand and kiss my hand in gratitude. Rather than that, somewhat to my chagrin, Reverend Tanner Franklin sat smiling gently and shaking his head in the negative, and looked at me very intently. Said, "Bless your heart, honey, you still got the matter. You still got the problem with you, ain't you? I know you struggling to get through it. I know you feel like you saying something mighty big to me there, talking about the white folks giving us the right to vote, talking about you white folks giving us the right to live in peace and dignity, talking about all the things you white folks want to give us. Well, honey, let me point out to you where you gone off. You see, you still thinking of me black and you white. So you talking about giving me something that I was born with the right to have, just like you born with the right to have it. The onlyest thing you white folks can do is keep us from getting it, which you have did all these years. Yes, honey. You got all the money and all the jobs. You got all the laws and all the policemans. And so you can deprive me from having it. But you can't give it to me, because it ain't yours to give. I done been born with that right, just like you was." Well, you know, for a moment I was kind of mad at him. My goodness, life, tried to be nice to these folks, and listen how he's talking back to me and all such as that. But you know, the more I reflected on it, the more I realized that is really what it is all about. And it was something of a turning point in my life. And I had a chance to really reflect on what Reverend Tanner Franklin had said to me.